Hello people, in this video we want to look at the treatment for Meniere's disease. In the previous videos we saw what exactly it is and the pathology, the etiology, the clinical features, variants of this disease and what exactly is Meniere's syndrome. Then we also looked at the examination and investigations, diagnosis, staging also we have looked at. Now finally we have come to treatment. So guys, if you want, please watch these videos, okay, and then come to the treatment, then only you understand why we are treating it in a certain way. We can treat Meniere's disease medically or surgically. These two, which these are somewhere in between, okay, neither, I mean, they are medical cum surgical kind of a thing. Okay, we'll look at these. Medical, let us look at. Okay, here we are, medical. So, general measures, what you will do is you will tell, reassure the patient and tell them that you will help them, etc. Because anxiety will be there, they don't know when they'll get the next attack. Tell them not to smoke, tell them to take low salt diet, because you know sodium is the whole cause that is irritating those hair cells in your inner ear, right? So low salt diet you should tell them, okay? Don't tell them not to take more water. What will happen if you take more water? Sodium water retention, etc. So water retention basically will lead to more indoor lymph, okay? Then don't take more coffee. Coffee, avoid coffee, okay? Coffee is bad. Water itself is bad. Coffee is bad. Okay, these people should not take excessive water. Anyways, overindulgence in coffee, tea, alcohol, not at all good. So stop smoking, stop alcohol, normal standard things that you write. Okay, avoid stress. Now stress also you avoid, because they think that stress, that is vasomotor disturbance, can be one of the causes you have seen in the etiology, right? Then avoid activities requiring balance, because you don't go and do gymnastics and then fall off, right? So if there is some activity that requires good body balance, then you avoid that, okay? Because you don't know when you will get the attack and you may just fall off. So this, what did you understand by all this? These are some general measures, right? So we are, before medical also, we have looked at some general measures. General measures we looked at. What did you see in general measures? We saw that, where are we here? To reassure the patient, tell them not to smoke and take alcohol, don't take more water, coffee, tea, then take low salt diet, then avoid stressful activities and anything that needs a perfect balance, like gymnastics, you're standing or you're a trapeze artist or you're walking on a rope, probably in a circus or some kind of a thing like that. Avoid those things because you don't know when you get an attack. Okay, then coming to medical management, right? For medical management you have two things: acute attack, how you will manage, and then chronic attack, chronic phase, how you'll manage. So under medical they have for acute and chronic. Okay, let us look at acute. Acute attack, what they are saying is again reassurance, bed rest, all that you will tell them. It's an acute attack, please take rest at that time. Intravenous fluids and electrolyte administration to combat their loss during vomiting. If this person has vomiting, then how will you handle it? Otherwise these people have, they told to take less water, isn't it? Then intravenous fluids if you give, interesting. Then basically they'll give them vestibular sedatives, guys, to relieve vertigo. How will you relieve vertigo? Vestibular sedatives. What are the sedatives? You should know promethazine, okay, then prochlorperazine. These two you have to remember. Promethazine, okay, promethazine, prochlorperazine. Just say these names, okay? Promethazine, prochlorperazine. So these are having tranquilizing effect. They suppress the activity of the medial vestibular nucleus. So exactly what are they doing? They are suppressing. See, endolymph is more only. That it is not doing anything. Endolymph is more, that they are not doing anything. It suppresses the activity of the medial vestibular nucleus. Where is this? Looks like it's somewhere in the brain stem, isn't it? Part of medulla. Vestibular nuclei is a part of the medulla. Then what is, they're talking about some vasodilators. So it will increase the cerebral vasodilation and improves labyrinth circulation. Labyrinthine circulation. So more blood endolymph will be absorbed, isn't it? That's what we learned. So we're done with management of acute attack. Reassure, bed rest, give them something for vomiting. Then vestibular sedatives like promethazine and prochlorperazine, right? That is Temetil. Right, and what will these do? They will suppress the activity of the medial vestibular nucleus. They have a tranquilizing effect. They have a tranquilizing effect. Okay. Then you can also give some vasodilators. Now coming to management of chronic pain. Guys, where are we? Here in the treatment of Meniere's disease, we have finished general measures. Medical, we have seen acute. Now we are going to chronic phase. What do they mean by this chronic phase? When patient presents after the acute attack, the treatment, what will you do after the acute attack? Same vestibular sedatives, guys. Prochlorperazine, Stemetil, 10 mg. Then you have vasodilators. Vasodilators, there also they were talking about, right? Here also they're talking about. That is beta-histine. That is also called as Wertin. This increases the labyrinthine blood flow by releasing histamine. So basically there's vasodilation, right? But this person should not go into low BP. What do you think? So you're giving them beta-histine vasodilator. So it will increase the labyrinthine blood flow. This causes reabsorption of the endolymph. But it is not going to be immediately happening. But you will give them what, guys? Beta-histine. Why it is vasodilator? If you give histamine vasodilator, so there's more blood supply to the labyrinthine. Okay, then you will give diuretic. Why diuretic? Because you want to remove some water from the body so that the endolymph will become less, right? Thiazides you can give, like hydrochlorothiazide. But otherwise, what are they saying? Furosemide. Yeah, furosemide they are preferring. So furosemide you can remember. So this side looks like not much of importance they are giving. Eliminate the allergen. This is more like a general measure. Hormones. Like if it is hypothyroidism, then you will treat the hypothyroidism with what? Thyroid replacement therapy. Okay. So hypothyroidism you will treat. Is that correct? Investigation should be directed to find the any endocrinal disorders such as hypothyroidism, and appropriate treatment replacement therapy should be given. Okay. So the most of the patients, they are saying you can manage off with this medical medical management. You can manage. Okay. So general measures you saw, then acute attack you saw, chronic also we saw. So what and all you have to write? Chronic vestibular sedatives like prochlorperazine, Stemetil, then beta histine that is Wertin, then diuretics like furosemide. Okay. Then eliminate the allergen, and then you can also give them treatment for hypothyroidism. Then coming to surgical. Now here there are some things which are falling in between the surgical and medical. See, look at this intermittent low pulse pressure therapy and then gentamicin via microwave. Okay, let us look at this first one. Intermittent low pressure pulse therapy. Okay, what is that? So here, look at this image here. So this is your tympanic membrane, right? Because here you have the ossicles. This is tympanic membrane. They have put some pipe kind of a thing here. That's a grommet, right? And they are giving some pulses. So these pulses, pressure pulse therapy, low pressure pulse therapy, the pressure waves passes through the ventilation tube. Oh, they are calling it as a ventilation tube. To the, where is this pressure going? To the round window membrane. So that is here. So round window membrane, guys, from this ventilation tube to the round window membrane, it is transmitted to the perilymph. Okay, that is yellow, and this will compress this perilymph. When it is getting pressure, the perilymph will put pressure on this scala media, right? So what will happen? There is compression of the endolymphatic labyrinth, and it will redistribute endolymph pressure to sac. So from here it will go to the sac and it will get drained out. Nice, right? So this is your low pulse pressure therapy, intermittent. Why did we put it under surgical procedures? Because they need a device called as MINIETT device therapy. Okay, so they need this device. So guys, they'll have to do a myringotomy, that is a hole in this tympanic membrane, and they have to insert this ventilation tube. Okay, ventilation tube, guys, it's not a grommet, remember, it's a ventilation tube. Right, and then pressure waves, what pulses you're giving of pressure. So you saw how it works, and it will make sure that the endolymph gets absorbed by the endolymphatic sac. Okay, nice, right? So we are done with one. What is it? We are done with this intermittent low pulse pressure therapy. Then we'll go to the next one, gentamicin via microwave. This is again somewhere in between surgery and medical. Let us look at this. See, gentamicin basically is a vestibulotoxic drug. So it will harm the vestibular part, but not the cochlear, not that much cochleotoxic. So what will happen? They're doing a chemical labyrinthectomy. All these they will do only if they cannot manage it. Okay. So what they're doing here, they're going to destroy the labyrinth. Okay. So they're going to give biweekly injections into the middle ear. How? The drug is absorbed through the round window. So how will they do this? They'll have a micro wick. So this one, micro wick. Can you see this? There's a micro wick. So they will deliver the drug here, and through the micro wick via the round window, it is going there and it is going to do damage to the vestibule. Right? A small wick is going to deliver the drug. So here again, you need a tympanostomy tube. This is a grommet. This is a grommet, guys. Here we are using grommet. This word grommet is coming in this gentamicin thing. The other place they used a ventilation tube, they use the word. But here they are telling grommet. Okay. And then you will give gentamicin to destroy the vestibular labyrinth. So guys, these people, they are destroying the vestibular labyrinth. Okay. But hearing they will not have problem because it is not cochleotoxic. Okay, so we are done with the another one, guys. How's it going? We are done with one more, that is gentamicin via microwave. Then we have decompressed section of labyrinthectomy. Let's look at this. So, okay, this one, decompress the endolymphatic sac. So they want to decompress it. Below the Donaldson's line, they will see behind the ear, they have opened, and here you have this Donaldson's line below which they are having this endolymphatic sac which they want to decompress. This Donaldson's line is an imaginary line extending from the lateral semicircular canal and bisecting the posterior semicircular canal. Okay. Then you have the endolymphatic shunt operation. A tube is put connecting the endolymphatic sac with subarachnoid space to drain the excess endolymph. So you want to put a shunt so that it will drain out the endolymph. Guys, did you understand what procedures we spoke of here? You will decompress it, and then you will also put a shunt or something to the subarachnoid space, right? So that you can drain the excess endolymph. Then coming to one more thing is there here, saculotomy or fix operation. Basically, here they are piercing the saccule, guys, with a needle, and saculotomy. They are piercing the cochlear duct is punctured. Okay, if you want to learn all this, you can look at these. Then coming to a section of vestibular nerve itself, they are cutting off, right? But you will preserve the hearing. Hearing part you will retain, only the, you will section the what? Vestibular nerve. See, vestibulocochlear nerve has two parts, vestibular part and the cochlear part. So they were sectioning off the vestibular part. Ultrasonic destruction of vestibular labyrinth, cochlear function is preserved. Just like how they destroyed with gentamicin the vestibular labyrinth, here they are doing ultrasonic destruction of the vestibular labyrinth, cochlear function is preserved. So the person can hear. Then lastly, guys, destructive procedures. Finally, they're talking about labyrinthectomy. We have come to the last one, guys. Labyrinthectomy. Labyrinthectomy, basically what you will do, you will destroy the labyrinth completely. Labyrinth, membranous labyrinth completely, if you destroy, what will happen? Both hearing also will go off, and even this vestibular part also will go off, right? So both functions will be gone. The person cannot hear also. Why? Because earlier itself he had no hearing. Only that time they will do this procedure. Labyrinthectomy, okay? So guys, we are done with the surgical. Surgical, what and all you saw, mainly decompress the endolymphatic sac, put a shunt into a subarachnoid space, you section the vestibular nerve, ultrasonically you can destroy the vestibular part. Finally, if the person has no hearing, anyways, to this labyrinthectomy, both cochlear, entire membranous labyrinth they will remove. So even cochlear part will go, but anyways, he had no hearing, so it's fine. So in this video, we have looked at treatment for Meniere's disease. Let's take a recap. So in general measures, we saw that we should tell them not to smoke alcohol, don't take much coffee, water or tea, and tell them to take low salt diet, and then don't take too much stress, and don't do activities that need severe balance, you know, like you need perfect balance kind of a thing. Then how to manage an acute attack, you again reassure, bed rest, you tell the person and give them for treating vomiting. Then take vestibular sedatives like promethazine, prochlorperazine, That is Demeter, and then this, what will they do? They will have a tranquilizing effect. They will suppress the activity of the medial vestibular nucleus. Okay. Then vasodilators. Similarly, chronic phase vasodilators like beta histine vertin. That is, it will release histamine vasodilation. So endolymph will get absorbed, but this is not going to be having immediate effect. Vestibular sedatives like same thing, prochlorperazine, that is Demeter. And then that is 10 mg thrice a day, like that they have told. Okay. Diuretics like furosemide. Then you can tell them to eliminate any allergen that they think they can cause this Meniere's disease for them. Hypothyroidism you will treat. Okay, this, all this is after an acute attack. Then surgical, start with something that is between surgical and medical. This is like you'll do a myringotomy and give them a ventilation tube so that you have low pressure pulse therapy. That is a MINET device therapy, MINET device therapy, where you, what will happen? This diagram you can draw in the exam by this ventilation tube to the round window. Then it goes to perilymph. The perilymph will squeeze on your endolymph, and endolymph will go into the endolymphatic sac and get drained. As simple as that. But you need to do a myringotomy. Then coming to this gentamicin, intratympanic gentamicin therapy. This is called as chemical labyrinthectomy. Here what will happen, you will have to give a micro wick, right, via a tympanostomy tube. So you're going through the middle ear also. That is why it is not just myringotomy, it is tympanotomy. You're going via this, and you're having a grommet, right, via which you have a microwick, where which will take the gentamicin and put it on your round window, and that will destroy the labyrinth. This is a chemical labyrinthectomy. Guys, pay attention here. So you will give how much and all have they told, how much of gentamicin should be given, etc. Basically, this gentamicin is vestibulotoxic, okay. So then coming to actual surgeries, what they want to do, they want to decompress the endolymphatic sac, that is below the Donaldson's line. You will get the endolymphatic sac, decompress it. Also, you can give a shunt from the endolymphatic sac into the subarachnoid space so that you can drain the excess endolymph. Then you can do some saculotomy, cochleosaculotomy, etc. You can section the vestibular nerve, but you can preserve the hearing by this. And then ultrasonic destruction you can do of the vestibular labyrinth. Destructive procedures, last one we talked, when the person has no hearing anyways, give them a labyrinthectomy. Completely destroy the membranous labyrinth, okay, which has the endolymph. Membranous labyrinth is completely destroyed. Okay guys, so we are done with this topic, Meniere's disease, which is very important for your exam. We'll meet you in the next video. Bye bye.